change us if we allow it to. It is just a matter of how we've come and how we've prepared our hearts to receive God's word this morning. So let's go to Lord in prayer, and let's dive right into God's word today. Father, we thank you for who you are. We thank you for all things, Lord. We thank you for health through our bodies. We thank you, God, that we're here this morning. We're able to worship you in spirit and in truth. I pray, Lord God, that you would just continue to move in a great and awesome way. God, may we receive your word today in this place. And I pray that you would anoint your servant as he speaks your word. May he speak nothing more, nothing less. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Well, we've been talking about the legacy of a name and how names have been changed throughout the Bible. Today, we're going to be focusing on a character named Paul, or also known as Saul. And, you know, as I look at change, I think some change happens naturally. You know, they say it happens, right? And some change happens supernaturally. There seems to be something divine that is involved. And some change happens intentionally. And the Apostle Paul certainly covers a few of these categories. You know, he went from a transition from Saul to Paul in the book of Acts, which that's where we're going to be today. And this is one of the most well-known name changes in the Bible. This was a man who gave his life to persecute the modern church, and now who writes two-thirds of the New Testament in which we read. It's quite a transition, isn't it? Someone who persecutes the church and faith in Jesus Christ and has believers martyred and killed, and all of a sudden he has an experience with God. He has a moment where he has changed, and then he goes from persecuting the church to then expanding the church. It's kind of an amazing transition, and I want to walk us through that transition today. We're going to start in Acts 9, verses 1 through 2, because I want to be very clear on who Paul was before Jesus. I think sometimes we forget who Paul was. We read his writings and we forget who he used to be. It's very important to remember who we used to be and who people used to be, and watch the progression in our lives, because this will be an encouragement to us and it will be an encouragement to others. Can someone say amen? Let's go to verse 1. It says, "Meanwhile, Saul was uttering threats with every breath and was eager to kill the Lord's followers." So this kind of sets it up right, the kind of guy that he was. "So he went to the high priest. He requested letters addressed to the synagogues in Damascus, asking for their cooperation in the arrest of any followers of the way he found there. And he wanted to bring them, both men and women, back to Jerusalem in chains." So Saul's nature was to harm people, was to harm believers. That was his nature. We are certainly known by our nature, aren't we? And it's unfortunate, though, that our name invokes a feeling or an idea of who we are. Or, you know, you go through this process when you're naming kids as well. It's like you start to throw out names, and husband and wife are talking about, let's name him this, let's name him that. And eventually you get to a name that you like, but the other person maybe had some involvement with that person in their life. You know what I'm saying? And they're like, "No, I hate that name. So-and-so had that name, and I know what kind of person they were." How many know what I'm talking about? It's just so true. You know what I mean? It's like, "I love that name," but then, "Oh, well, no, remember in high school that one who had that name?" It was like, "Oh, man, that's the worst." And every time we'll call our kid that name, it's like, "Oh, yeah, we don't want to think about that." It's just so funny how names kind of invoke this idea of what a person is like and who they are. I think this can work to our advantage, but also this can work to our disadvantage as well. So let's move ahead here. I'm going to read kind of a lengthy passage here, Acts 9, 3 through 20. I'm just going to go straight through. I want to just take your mind here, okay, because sometimes we can just listen to the scripture specifically, and it's the most important part. So we need to really take in what is taking place here in this story. And I didn't want to leave anything out. Verses 3 through 20. This is Saul's conversion experience. Verse 3. "As he was approaching Damascus on this mission, a light from heaven suddenly shone around him. He fell to the ground and he heard a voice saying to him, 'Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me?' 'Who are you, Lord?' Saul asked. The voice replied, I am Jesus, the one who you are persecuting. Now get up and go to the city, and you will be told what you must do. Then the men with Saul stood speechless, for they heard the sound of someone's voice, but saw no one. And Saul picked himself up from the ground, but when he opened his eyes, he was blind. So his companions led him by the hand to Damascus, and he remained there blind for 3 days, and he did not eat or drink. There was a believer in Damascus named Ananias, and the Lord spoke to him in a vision, calling Ananias. Yes, Lord, he replied. And the Lord said, go over to the straight street to the house of Judas. And when you get there, ask for a man from Tarsus named Saul. He is praying to me right now. I have shown him a vision of a man named Ananias coming in and laying hands on him so he can see again. But Lord, exclaimed Ananias, I've heard many people talk about the terrible things this man has done to the believers in Jerusalem. I want you to kind of take that in for a second. God is speaking to this man, hey, go and pray over this person. And then he's saying, well, I don't know if you've heard or not, but he's kind of doing things to our people, so this better be you. But the Lord said, go, for Saul is my chosen instrument to take my message to the Gentiles and to kings, as well to the people of Israel. And I will show him how much he must suffer for my name's sake. So Ananias went and found Saul. He laid hands on him and said, Brother Saul, the Lord Jesus, who appeared to you on the road, has sent me to you so you might regain your sight and be filled with the Holy Spirit. Instantly, something like scales fell from Saul's eyes, and he regained his sight. And he got up, and he was baptized. Afterwards, he ate some food, which was probably his favorite part, and regained his strength. Saul stayed with the believers in Damascus for a few days, and immediately he began preaching about Jesus in the synagogue, saying, he is indeed the Son of God. This conversion experience can help us, but also hinder us if we do not catch all of the details. Because we live in a society, especially right now, that people want a Damascus Road experience without any moments of blindness in their life. They want God to show up in miraculous ways and show himself, but yet we don't want to walk through 3 days of hunger and darkness while someone else leads us to where we're going. We miss the conversion experience of Saul to Paul here because we miss that he went through hardship with his conversion. Many people want the sky to split open and for Jesus to say, hey, you know, follow me. But then yet we don't want to go through with that process. The process did not start with God speaking to Saul and saying, hey, come follow me. And he immediately went and preached the gospel. No, he was blind and he didn't eat for 3 days. And he was led like a child by his hand to a place where he didn't even know where he was going. Catch that about his conversion experience. We want God to show up, but we are not willing to feel our way through the darkness. Don't over-spiritualize the conversion experience so much that you miss the thing that you have to walk through. Is our conversion a spiritual thing? Absolutely it is a spiritual thing, but it is also a decision. You decide to say yes to Jesus. Now, Paul was seemingly forced because he's blinded and God speaks to him. I would probably follow as well at this point. But he still, the 3 days, it seems that there is silence. Are you with me? It seems that there is silence, that there's not much happening from what the word says anyway. There's nothing recorded to where there was this continual conversation with God. It was boom, God says, this is what I want you to do. Now, walk and go. Have this person lead you by the hand. 3 days, I'm not eating. And he's probably wondering what has taken place. Isn't this much like our conversion experience? I could remember being a teenager and praying a prayer. Jesus, come into my life and change me. And I remember the feeling, how amazing it was to know that my sins were forgiven. And there was nothing monumental. It was in a back room somewhere around Liberty University and a thing called Scare Mare we used to go to with youth group trips. And as I walked away from that moment, I thought, this is awesome. I'm saved. But then the next morning, How many know what I'm talking about? The next day, I thought to myself, did anything really happen? Did that really happen? Did I really pray? And did Jesus really save me? Because I don't feel as good right now as I did yesterday. I don't feel as amazing now as I did yesterday. Are you with me? There's not a guy there leading me into prayer. There's not someone there that is taking me by the hand. I know I prayed it, but I don't know if the change really happened. I'm preaching to someone this morning that has said, God, come into my heart, and now you're having trouble because it's like, I don't feel like what I did. Faith is not all about feeling. Now, I love feelings. I love when I feel something. Amen. I love when I'm preaching and I feel something. I love when I'm in prayer and I feel something. But there are times, can I tell you, that when I go to prayer, I don't feel a thing, but I know He is there. I know God hears me. I know God is leading me. He is guiding me. We want God to show up, but many times we're not willing to walk through the darkness. Just because it doesn't feel spiritual doesn't mean that it's not spiritual. Can I tell you that? Just because it doesn't feel spiritual doesn't mean it's not spiritual. Saul's nature changed. I want you to catch this because here's the deal. This is what I love. This is the details about the word sometimes that I love so much. Saul's nature changed, but his name stayed the same. You know, when I read that story, Saul goes to Paul instantly. And you know, that didn't actually happen. Notice that when God spoke to Saul, He still called him Saul. God did not say, Paul, Paul. He said, Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? We understand that Saul may have changed, but the stigma about him was still the same. Are you with me? We know this because even Ananias, even as God spoke to him, there's a man coming, and this is who he is. The stigma of the name of Saul was still on him. You see, he said, okay, this is great that I'm supposed to pray for this person, and you know, they're supposed to be like, fill the Holy Spirit stuff and like scales from their eyes, whatever, that's cool. Who was it again? It was Saul, you know, who knows that if his cousin's brother's uncle's nephew wasn't dragged away by this guy? Are you with me? We don't know the stories that are kind of intertwined in this, and that's why he says, for some reason, there's this feeling invoked inside of him that says, I don't know about this guy. Maybe this is like some kind of fake thing where he's going to come after me, and this is like a ploy. He's going to pretend to be a Christian, and maybe he's not. Are you with me? Even though he was converted, he had to convince, and I want to encourage someone today that even though you have been converted and Jesus Christ has changed your heart and your life, there are people that you have to convince. You don't have to convince God, but you do have to convince people. I want you to know that. That just because you say yes to Jesus, you're not going to go to work the next day and they're just going to say, oh, there's just a glow all around you. I just see it. You just look so amazing. Look, you're just so different. I can just tell. You're just so amazing. You might get one or two people that notice the change instantly. Some people are going to be like, oh, you prayed? Well, that'll wear off. Oh, you're doing the church thing? Well, that won't last. It's a fad. Don't be discouraged when you go to a place and you say you're following Jesus now and not everybody is with you. Not everybody gets it. Not everybody's for you. Not everybody says, oh, great. Let's, you know what? At lunch today, let's gather. I'm going to pay for your lunch. I'm going to bring all our coworkers around and we're going to pray together. It's going to be so awesome because you're a brother and sister in the Lord now. How many know that doesn't happen? Amen and amen. Send me on the work site, like, listen, it's actually the opposite. They will make fun of you. They will ridicule you. They will chastise you. They will do these things to you because you are a Christ follower. Well, you're in good company. Even though he was converted, he had to convince. He had to work through the doubt and disbelief of others. You ever had to work through doubt and disbelief of others that you knew God had changed you, but yet people didn't believe you yet? I've experienced that in my life personally, that when I became a Christ follower, it's like not everybody gets that. Most of my friends certainly thought that it was because I was chasing around a blonde-headed girl that was a Christian, so they thought, oh, well, he's going to do the Christian thing now so he can get the blonde-headed girl. I mean, it is a good idea, but you know, that kind of thing doesn't last. That kind of thing doesn't last. And It takes some time of convincing people that you are a Christ follower. But how do you do that? I just got three real simple points for this, is that you convince people through, number one, your consistency. Because Paul, he convinced people that he was a Christ follower through his consistency. He didn't up and leave the moment after. He stayed, and he stayed in the synagogues, and he talked about Jesus, and he shared with the apostles. And understand, the apostles, even the apostles, the first apostles, were not super stoked. I want you to understand. You know, the original 12 weren't super stoked that this guy who persecuted the church was now in the church. See, we think that everybody, that, you know, Jesus spoke to Saul, and everybody's like, oh, let's just welcome him in. No, they're thinking, could this be something to destroy the church? And so they were on guard. They were on guard. Is this person the real deal? Because we know what he's capable of. He also convinced them through his character. Through his character. And thirdly, through his new Christ-centered nature. He was Christ-centered now. His life was self-centered before with his agenda, but now his life was Christ-centered. If you want to make an impact around your workplace, in your life, can I tell you that it's not always these super spiritual, sky-splitting, monumental things that will change people's mind about you. It is the hard things like consistency. It is the hard things like character. It is the hard things like you didn't get your way, but you responded correctly. It is the hard things like now your nature is changed to be more Christ-like. We make these things so monumental when really they are just ground-level things. They are simple, but they are hard. Please hear me. They are hard. They are hard. Being consistent is hard. I want to encourage you and tell you, like, oh, yeah, the angels will just float you right in here on Sunday morning. It'll be fantastic. I wish that would have happened for me last week. It didn't. First time in 10 years I had to miss because of illness. It was crazy. I was so irritated about it, so frustrated about it. But I had to decide, even in my illness and in my sickness, would I give God praise? Even in my illness and in my sickness, would I say, thank you, Lord? I want you to touch me and heal me and do it quickly if you could. But even as I lay here at the throne, I will still I will praise you. You know, it's important that we are consistent. It's important that when you don't feel like it, you open the book that can give you life. It's important that when you don't feel like it, you lift your hands and praise, even if your mind's not right yet. Lift your mind, lift your heart and lift your hands to God, and your mind begins to get clear. Praise does a funny thing in your life. It begins to clear the cloudiness out of the way, even when it doesn't make sense. I really want you to know this. Scripture doesn't mention God changing Saul's name to Paul. From what I can find, Scripture does not indicate that God changed Saul's name. Oh my gosh. So, is everything I learned a lie? No. Maybe we just didn't see the whole picture. I know certainly I didn't, and some here today, you're probably like, yeah, man, I saw that a long time ago. That's cool. Well, it's cool. Maybe there's something. Just look for a one-liner here that can change your day. But as I begin to read this scripture, I saw God didn't change his name. Not in chapter 9, not in chapter 10, not in chapter 11, not in chapter 12, not until chapter 13 do I see that there starts to be a transition, and it is not a quick change either. Look at this. I'm just going to just blast through some verses. You can check out chapter 13 later. It's your homework for today. We don't really give homework, but if you're a visitor, you're like, oh, there's homework. I'm not coming back. All right, Acts 13, just going to blast these verses. Acts 13, verse 4, I'm just going to read portions of them. It says, so Barnabas and Saul were sent out by the Holy Spirit. Whoa, the Holy Spirit sent out Saul, not Paul. Saul, his name was still the same. Then just a couple verses later, verse 9 says, Saul, also known as Paul, was filled with the Spirit. Chapter 13, verse 13 says, Paul and his companions. You see that? Like five or six verses there. There's like, okay, they call him Saul. Paul, formerly known as Saul. Paul. I feel like that's the way it's going to be with the name of our church. You know what I mean? It's like Soul Harvest. Northbend, the church that used to be Soul Harvest. You know what I'm saying? Northbend, right? I feel like that's going to be what it is. I was actually, last week I was having a procedure. I mean, I got four kids. It's obvious. I mean, I'm fine. It's okay. I didn't want you to think like there's something wrong with me. You know what I mean? Like I got some serious health issues. No. It was just a quick thing. And so I'm in there. This has got a point. I knew this would like unfortunately come out somehow. And it just did as I started telling the story. It's like, oh dear Lord. And so I go in and like it's an hour away. So I'm like, I don't know anybody. Surely I don't know anybody an hour away. Surely. So we're sitting there, we're talking, and this person comes in. It's super awkward anyway, right? Those things are just super awkward. And hey, just like small talk and stuff. And she says something about what I did or something. It's always awesome. Oh, Pastor, sweet. Even more awkward. And so we start talking, and come to find out, this girl is kind of local, like within a 20-minute drive of here. And we start talking about churches, and I know the church she goes to because I preach there. It's awesome. And start talking about, she's like, oh, what church do you pastor at? I'm like, Northbend Church. She's like, oh, I've never heard of that. I was like, well, you know, we're already this far. I was like, well, we just had name change. It was a 10-year anniversary of change in North Bend. I said, you used to be Soul Harvest Church. I know who you are. And as I left that day, I said, listen, I really hope this doesn't affect anything when I come to preach at your church. All that being said, I feel like there will be this transition of one name to another name to another name. And that transition is natural. But here's the thing, we're going somewhere with this because Saul had a name change and a transition to where it was a practical change for a spiritual purpose. I don't want you to miss this. Don't miss it. The change of Paul's name was a practical change for spiritual purpose. God did not change Saul's name. Get that? God didn't say, hey, I'm going to change your name now. You're going to go by Paul. Is that cool? No, it's Saul. Paul, formerly known as Saul. Paul. Everything we do practically should connect people to the gospel. Practically and spiritually. Everything we do that is on the practical level should connect people spiritually. So if I could just talk about the name changes briefly, is that the name change is a spiritual thing, but the name change is absolutely a practical thing. And we must not think that change that doesn't split the heavens from God is not change that God doesn't want. Because sometimes we got to think about how are we going to connect people as we move ahead with what God is doing in the midst of us. The church for so long has forsaken the practical and clung to the spiritual, and now they're no earthly good. Are you with me? Because people can be so much up here and they live up here that you talk to people and they look at you like, what the heck are you talking about? We talk in a language that people don't understand. We talk in scripture references and tones that people say, what is wrong with this person? We must think about, as we go forward as believers, how are we connecting our life practically with spiritually? Practically with spiritually. Listen, his name indicated his new nature. Paul's new name indicated his new nature. And his name indicated his new mission. I don't want you to miss this. Way up in verse 3, it was like, as he was approaching Damascus on this mission, on the mission to what? On the mission to destroy the church, God intervened. So we see that his mission changed. Has anyone ever had a mission change in life? It becomes less about you and more about him. Paul's change of name was an external change indicating an internal change. And that's a lot of like what baptism is. It's an external thing taking place that is indicating an internal thing. Are you with me? So let's check out this progression here from Saul to Paul. It starts out Saul. Then it says Paul, formerly known as Saul. And then it goes straight to Paul. I think this is an amazing thing. It's also noted that Paul was called to the Gentiles. I'm just trying to teach you something. If you don't know this, it's cool. I'm just hopefully just kind of giving you a little quick lesson here. Paul was a Jew. And he first went to the Jews to share with them the gospel. Well, he got a lot of kickback from the Jewish people. You know what I mean? Like, they didn't want to hear it. They didn't want to receive it. And he was getting kind of frustrated. And if you notice, that's all kind of around 13. I want you to look at that. It's all kind of around 13. And then Paul, listen, we would be so offended by Paul because Paul's just like, listen, I'm done with you. I'm going to go take this thing to someone who actually listened and get it. That's my version. That's why they don't ask me to write paraphrases. But he says, listen, I'm done. I'm going to take the message to the Gentiles. And God places that on his heart to take this message to all the world. Notice this. Saul, the name Saul is of different heritage than Paul, different background. Paul was more of a Gentile name. Are you with me? My goodness. I'm just going to walk slow. Listen, Paul was more of a Gentile name. So isn't it interesting that Saul changes to Paul? His name changes to match the people that he's called to reach. And it is a practical change for spiritual purpose. This is what I love about it, is that our walk with Christ can look very similar. It took Paul time, but shortly Paul overtook Saul. Now, this is what I mean by that. He was different when his name was Saul. Notice his name didn't have to change for him to be different. He was different. It took time, but soon Paul overtook Saul, and his new nature was remembered more than his old nature. Paul's new nature was remembered more than his old nature. So in time, as Paul's name continued to spread all throughout the region and all throughout the area, people soon began to forget about Saul. They soon forgot who he used to be, and now they see who he was. And that is just like our walk in our life with Jesus, is that if we continue and we are consistent, we are faithful, people will forget about who you used to be. And then they will start to see you as who you are now. I don't want to call people out too much. I don't want to get on rabbit trails too much this morning, but I just want to say there's someone on the front row, my right side, your left, head of the Fresh Start Center. He shared with me a while back about he saw someone here, and he was like, oh my goodness, no way, you know, no way. Remembered, you know, what he used to be like and thought, I'm sure, because see, when you haven't seen someone in 10 years or 15 years, your last encounter is your next encounter. Are you with me? It doesn't matter what changes went on in people's life. Somehow still, there's a trigger inside that says, oh, snap. Now I remember. And he was sharing with me that, man, I was so tore up because I just remember. And he told me this. So this is beautiful and it's powerful. He said, He's moved after service. He went and found the person and just began to share with him, like, listen, I just want to let you know, God's done so much in my life. God's changed me. God has, you know, changed my heart, changed my mind. I'm not the same person that I used to be. And it was a cool conversation. And they began to talk through things. And I don't know exactly what the person said. Maybe something like, you know, that's a long time ago. That's our classic go-to. But I want to tell you something right now. Even though things are a long time ago, there's something about when a person sees the transformation of another, and it's spoken, but it's also seen in the heart and in the eyes. There's something about that, that people connect with that. And then it begins to cause them to think, could God for me? Can I tell you that there have been times that I've continued in my walk with Jesus simply because people say this, I don't care what people think about me. You ain't thinking right. I do care. There have been times in my walk when I've continued simply because how would this affect somebody else? If I don't show up, how's this going to affect someone who's counting on me? If I'm not here, how's it going to affect the house? If I'm not invested, how's this going to affect someone else? Listen, sometimes I show up not because I want to, but for the sake of others, knowing that what people think does matter. And we need to show people that there's been a change and transition in our life and in our heart. And I'm talking about showing up in your Christian walk, showing up in an example, showing up in the workplace, being who Christ wants you to be. Show up for Jesus first. But there are times when you will remember that you're showing up for people as well. It says, love God and love people. Now, I'm a firm believer that you cannot love people properly if you don't first love God properly. But let me tell you this right now. Sometimes you got to show up for the sake of someone else, because Paul, as he was showing up and people were seeing him, he was preaching the gospel, he's being faithful, he's being committed, they soon begin to forget who that guy used to be. And it's certainly by the time the next generation came around, his old life was just a story. It wasn't even remembered by the next generation. It was just a story of who he used to be. Here's what I really love. His present became his past. His present became his past. Sometimes we want to fast forward to the future, but you can't miss the present. His present eventually became his past. And can I tell you that this morning you're here, this is the present, but this will soon become your past. So the things that you are doing today will make way for tomorrow, and so on and so forth. It is the little decisions that make up the big decisions. It is the little things that make up the big things. Are you with me? I can chalk up my life to a few big decisions, but here's the thing. It's a lot of little decisions that lead to a few big decisions. But without the little decisions, nothing really matters. Without reading God's word when you don't feel like it, nothing really matters. Without praying when you don't feel like it, nothing really matters. Without showing up to God's house when you know you need to, nothing really matters. It's the little decisions that will cause your present to become your past. And we have the opportunity to choose what that looks like. As he moved forward, he was less of Saul and more of Paul. I love that. His name didn't have to change, but it did to indicate something. It did to indicate who this new man was. He was no longer that man. Goes on to write 2/3 of the New Testament, and we think that's such a glorious and beautiful thing. Can I tell you that when God uses you, it's not always glorious and glamorous, but it is an amazing thing. How much hardship and persecution Paul faced by writing that and going through that, many times in prison and in difficulty, but yet he had joy. And so I want to let you know right now that if you're going through difficulty, walk through it with joy. Walk through it with joy. I want to share something. Sometimes, you know, you think you come to church, you're like, I don't want to fake it. Let me tell you something. I will walk in this place, and if I feel like my leg's falling off, I'm going to say, God's good. God is good. How you doing? I'm doing good. Now, if we have a side conversation, say, you feeling all right? I'm doing all right, but listen, I'm struggling, but God's good. I don't allow my mouth to lead the way for creating negative thought process and thinking and a continuation of down that road of negativity. You can take or leave that. You don't have to. You might think that's huff and fluff preaching. Can I go ahead, be negative all you want. But I'm going to smile. How are you? God is good. God is good. He's faithful and he's worthy of all praise. Testing asks you this question, because Paul went through some testing. It wasn't just God showed up, split the sky, and everything was amazing. Paul went through testing, and testing will ask you this question: are you willing? It's a simple question. Are you willing? Are you willing? Are you willing? Testing will ask you that. Are you willing? We can say, yes, I'm willing, when our favorite song is playing on the radio and we just came out of a great service and our bellies are full and whatever our favorite eat is after Sunday morning church. We can say, are we willing? Easily. Yes, if all is well in our life. But what about when there's testing? Are you willing? I want to encourage you today to move forward, because your present will become your past. Our testimony is only developed when we move through tests. Our testimony is only developed when we move through tests. So if you are experiencing a test right now in your faith, if you're struggling, can I tell you, move forward. Your testimony is only developed when you move through tests. But if you're not going through a test, know this, there will be one to come, and how you respond in it will greatly determine the next step, the next place, and the direction of your life. Be consistent. Be people of character. Be people of Christ-centered nature. It doesn't always feel good, no, but God is always good. Our circumstances do not determine who our God is. Our surroundings don't determine who our God is. He's good all the time. Let's stand to our feet this morning. Lord, today we first and foremost give you praise. We thank you for your word.